The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome. On behalf of the people who are Beaumont Presbyterian Church, we're so grateful that you're joining us this day to worship God. A few announcements before we get going this day. Some of you have received a letter in the mail. If you have not received it, I'll let you know right now that the session has decided, made the difficult but right decision, I believe, to go ahead and commit to not worshiping in person for the rest of this calendar year. In other words, we are not going to have in-person worship at least until 2021. And the reason for that, the main reason for that decision, is that Advent and Christmas is only 2 months away, and as Wayne and I and others plan for worship, we kind of needed to know what worship was going to look like. So the session talked and discerned and decided that they did not think that circumstances would change such that we would be safe having indoor, in-person worship. So we recognize that for many of us, for probably all of us, that's very difficult news. I suspect, long for the day that we can come back together in this room and to hug one another and sing together and to be together physically. But we still maintain that the safety of this congregation and our neighbors is our highest priority. Now, we are going to do some things a little bit differently because we will not be worshiping in person. The Sundays of Advent and Christmas Eve, those services are going to be pre-recorded. And the reason those services are going to be pre-recorded is we want to make, since Advent and Christmas is such a special time in the life of this congregation and all congregations, wanted to make it as interactive as possible. So if we do a live stream like we're doing right now, we're pretty much stuck with what you're looking at right now, this angle and these folks, which we're all grateful, by the way. But if we do something pre-recorded, then it allows us to get more of the congregation involved. So, for example, we can have one family in their home video themselves lighting an Advent candle, and then we can patch that in so the congregation, so that y'all can have a little bit more participation in worship than what we're doing right now allows. So we are going to be doing that during Advent and Christmas. Also wanted to let you all know that this upcoming Wednesday, at 6 p.m., we are going to gather outside, right kind of out here in between the courtyard and Lane Allen, and we are going to have a brown bag dinner, a socially distanced brown bag dinner. Previous ones have been at 6:30, I know that, but we're going to move it up to 6, mostly because the sun's coming down a little bit sooner now. So from about 6 to 6:30, we're going to have a brown bag dinner. Bring your own food and bring your own chair. And then we'll stay socially distanced and have a meal together. And then at 6:30, we're going to worship together. It's going to look a little bit different, but what we're going to do is I'm going to pull out the PA system, and then we're going to have just a kind of a casual time of devotion together for about 30 minutes. I might bring my guitar, we might, you know, might strum along to a hymn or something like that. I'll read some scripture, we'll share some prayer concerns and have a worshipful time together. That's about the best we feel we can do right now. So we're going to do that this Wednesday at 6 p.m. If you, like me, are missing worshiping together physically, then come this Wednesday. Bring a friend, bring a chair, and we'll stay socially distanced and worship together and read scripture and prayer together. Again, this Wednesday at 6 p.m. Next week starts our stewardship season. Our theme this year is Our Money Story, and it comes with this devotional booklet. If you would like to order your free copy and have it mailed to you, please email Jennifer in the office or call by this Tuesday at 10 a.m. Also, if you would rather come by and pick one up, I'm going to put about a dozen or so copies of this in our blessing box out in front of our main doors if you want to come by and pick yours up. A few more things. Sorry, just a lot of announcements this day. Just another reminder about pastoral care. Pastoral care is different right now, but I'm here. If you need pastoral care, just want to talk or chat, give me a call. Shoot me an email. Send me a text. I'm very busy right now, but you will be a priority if you contact me about that. So I'm happy to speak over the phone. I'm also happy. I keep a camping chair in the back of my car. So if the weather's nice, you want to sit outside on your lawn or porch, I am available to do that as well. Finally, I also want to note that this has been a difficult week in the life of many of us here in Kentucky, especially with the tumultuous events of Wednesday and the grand jury's findings on the situation with Breonna Taylor. I just want to encourage us all to continue to bear witness to our friends and family who are persons of color who are lamenting right now. On Facebook and other places, I see a lot of people arguing about the legality of what happened and whether or not the police officers who killed Breonna Taylor were breaking the law. I would encourage us, especially those of us who are white, to keep in mind that, at least this is my opinion, that the legality of the matter is really besides the point. What happened was wrong. An innocent person was killed. And those of us who are Christian need to be constantly reminded that just because something is legal does not necessarily mean it's right. Just because something is legal does not necessarily mean that it's just. So together, let us bear witness to the laments of our siblings of color who are crying out for justice, and let us continue to affirm that Black Lives Matter and that us work to become a safer place for all folks. That is all of the announcements I have this day. So together, let's breathe as we do, and then John's going to lead us in our prayer of the day, and Lydia will lead us in our prelude. Let us breathe in God's mercies. And breathe out God's mercies to others. Let us breathe in God's mercies. And breathe out God's mercies to others. Let us breathe in God's mercies. And breathe out God's mercies to others. Friends, let us worship God.
Gracious God, we thank you for being ever present with us. We know that we are never alone. Your mercies have been faithful and rich. Pour out your Spirit upon us that we might do the work of your will in the name of the Creator, Redeemer, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise in body or in spirit and join us in our call to worship. Praise the Lord, who is our provider. The Lord is our hope. Our trust is in God. God brought us out of bondage and has made us free. The Lord is our hope. Our trust is in God. Glorious are the deeds of our God, and mighty are God's acts. The Lord is our hope. Our trust is in God. Come, let us worship God. Our first hymn this morning is number 391. This is the day. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor, trusting in the promise of forgiveness. Almighty God, we have been wandering in the wilderness of sin. We have complained in the face of your mercy. We have been selfish and conceited in the face of your sacrifice. We have not done your will. Teach us humility. Teach us gratitude. Infuse your spirit into our beings, so that we might be reconciled to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Friends, hear the renewing waters of God's mercies. People of God, our sins are forgiven. The Lord is loving, and we are reconciled to God. Therefore, let us humble and surrender ourselves to the will of God for the glory of the Lord. Alleluia.
Amen. Amen. O God, fill us with your Spirit and humble our hearts so that we can hear your word. Amen. Please join us in the responsive reading of Psalm 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Do not let those who wait for you be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I will wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me, for your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right, and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his decrees. For your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my guilt, for it is great. Who are they that fear the Lord? He will teach them the way that they should choose. They will abide in prosperity, and their children shall possess the land. The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes his covenant known to them. My eyes are ever towards the Lord, for he will pluck my feet out of the net. Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. Believe the troubles of my heart and bring me out of my distress. Consider my affliction and my trouble and forgive all my sins. Consider how many are my foes and with what violent hatred they hate me. O, guard my life and deliver me. Do not let me be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. May integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you. Redeem Israel, O God, out of all its troubles. Holy wisdom, holy word. Thanks be to God. Please join us in the sung response to our psalm, which you will find printed in your bulletin.
Friends, you may be seated. Our second scripture this day, our lectionary text from the Gospel of Matthew, is chapter 21, verses 23 through 32. Let's listen again for what God is saying to God's church. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven or was it of human origin? And they argued with one another. They said, if we say from heaven, he will say to us, why then did you not believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. And he said to them, well, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work in the vineyard today. He answered, I will not. But later changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said to the same. And he answered, I go, sir. But he did not go. Which of these two did the will of his father? They said, the first. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. Friends, holy wisdom, holy word. Thanks be to God. Thank you, choir, and thanks be to God. Friends, let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. All right, folks, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't have a sermon today. It just didn't happen this week. There, okay. No, this week, the Holy Spirit just didn't cooperate, and I kept on waiting for inspiration, and I finally sat down on Friday morning outside the Starbucks outside my home and wrote down about 75% of a sermon, and I woke up this morning and I realized that it was crap, and I did not want to give it to you all today. I'm just going to talk a few minutes about today's passage. If I start speaking in tongues, feel free to press the mute button. This is all I've got this week, and I hope that it will be enough. This is a series, the third in a series of three parables that we've looked over the past few weeks, and the beginning of today's parable starts off with this conflict between the Pharisees, the chief priests, and Jesus. And the chief priests and the Pharisees they're not big fans of Jesus. Remember, right before this chapter, Jesus had gone into the temple and flipped over tables because he was so furious with the money changers. So Jesus is threatening the status quo. He's threatening their status in the church, and they question Jesus about the authority that he has. And rather than play their game, Jesus gives this parable, which is the briefest of the three parables that we've gone through over the past few weeks. It's a very simple parable. A man gets up in the morning and he tells his two children to go out and work in the vineyard. One of them says that he will not, but then has some change of mind and then does end up working in the vineyard. The other child says that he will, but then doesn't. And then Jesus lifts up to the Pharisees and the chief priests and says, well, which one did the right thing? Which one did the will of the Father? And their response is, well, the first son. Even though he said he wasn't going to go work in the vineyard, he did. He may have said no, but he did yes. And the kind of the prevalent interpretation of this passage has been that Jesus has lifted up the son who said he wasn't, but then ended up doing it anyways, to kind of continue this pattern in Matthew of the first will be last and the last will be first, so that unlike the Pharisees and the chief scribes, the tax collectors and the prostitutes first said no, but then listened to John and listened to Jesus and had a change of heart and ended up doing the work of the kingdom. And some have said that this passage is to say that it doesn't matter so much what we say, but rather more what we do. I really struggle with that interpretation of this passage, and that's what I've been wrestling with all this week, because I don't want to live in a world where words don't matter, where really it doesn't matter what we say, but only what we do. Obviously, we as Christians have an empty faith if all we do is come and worship and say we're going to live by the Christian faith, but then go out into the world, into our classrooms, into the marketplace, into the ballot booth, into our social media, and what we do there doesn't reflect what we say. But I want to play with this parable, and I wish that there weren't two children. I wish that there were actually three children. One child that said no but did yes. A second child that said yes but did no. But then a third child that said yes and did yes. I want to combine the two children together, and hopefully that's what we are right now in this moment in history. That we have been asked to go work in the vineyard. Almost any time a vineyard is mentioned in the biblical narrative, it's a metaphor for what God is calling us to do as the beloved community. So in an ideal world, we don't do what the first child does or the second child, but rather what a third child does by saying yes and doing yes. Because I do believe that our words matter. Obviously, what we do matters, but our words matter as well. in this particular point in history, in the political conversation that's going on in our country right now, we have seen just how hurtful words can be. And I am raising a young woman right now. Trisha and I are raising our daughter, and I want her to grow up to be the third child, the child who says and does the same thing. As Jesus says elsewhere in the biblical narrative, let our yes be yes and our no be no. So much harm has been done on the, you know, by the church and those outside the church who have said one thing and done another. So today, I don't know if I have necessarily an answer for this, but I'm wrestling with this parable, and I hope that in this particular moment in history, we might play with this parable and imagine what it might be like for us to be the third child, so that what we do and say in here or your living room or wherever you are mirrors what we actually do out in the world. So that as we are called, as my stole says right here, to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly, that not just be some empty mantra, but that this may be a summons to go to the vineyard that Jesus is calling us to do. And friends, the vineyard is right wherever you are right now. So what do you think? A man had three sons. Which are we going to strive to be this day? Friends, in the name of God, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, may all of us, God's beloved children, say, Amen. Friends, our next hymn is hymn number 209. My song is Love Unknown.
My song is love unknown.
Friends, together let us affirm our affirmation of faith this day, the Apostles' Creed. Please join me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. A few prayer concerns this day I would like to share with you before we turn to God in prayer. Some of y'all got an email from me yesterday. I was contacted by Melody Kazee that Danny, her husband Danny, who has long been waiting for a new kidney, got the news that there was a kidney for him. So they went up to the University of Cincinnati Hospital yesterday for a 1 o'clock surgery. Unfortunately, Melody told me last night that something came up and they did some sort of test on the kidney that they thought was going to work, and it ended up not being a match. So we grieve with Danny and Melody at this setback. They have returned here to Lexington, but they still are maintaining hope that, you know, they're on the list. They've gotten a call, and Melody was telling me that they will get another one. So we continue to pray for Danny, that he may get his new kidney as soon as possible. So we pray for them during this time of holy waiting. Also wanted to say that Richie, is Lydia's, our organist Lydia's husband, had bariatric surgery this past week, and everything went well, and he is recovering. So we pray for Lydia and Richie, and pray that he may have a speedy recovery. And also want to continue to pray for all of us in our congregation, especially our older folks, especially those who live alone. This time can be very difficult for them. So we pray for them and seek ways to reach out for them and support them in this time of social distancing and isolation. So friends, let us pray. It will be a responsive prayer. So when I pray, Lord, in your mercy, we invite you to respond by saying, hear our prayer. So let us pray for the needs of the world, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, who is ever present, you hear our cries and are ever faithful in your mercy. We come to you with our concerns for ourselves, for our community, and for the world. For our church and its leaders, fill them with the spirits and mind of Christ so that they would serve you and others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our country and global community, enable our leaders on all sides of the aisle to make decisions for the sake of people and not profits, to serve others and not themselves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our local community, we pray this day, especially for those in the Commonwealth of Kentucky. This week at the announcement of the grand jury's finding on the murder of Breonna Taylor, we witness the pain of our brothers and our sisters who are persons of color, and we bear witness to their trauma, we bear witness to their lament, we bear witness to their anger. We ask this day that you would be with us, and that where laws are in place, where innocent people are harmed, that those laws may be changed. We pray that our elected leaders may do better, that they may take active steps to address systemic racism here in Kentucky and elsewhere. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who suffer with sickness, sadness, bereavement, anxiety, or abuse, envelop them in your love and help us to be their community. Lord, Lord, in your mercy. Hear our prayer. And for all other intentions we hold in our hearts this day, we pray especially for Danny and Melody, who were on the brink of such good news yesterday, and were told that they would need to wait some more. We pray for them in their waiting. We pray that a kidney may be found quickly for Danny, and that it may be a good match, and that his body would accept it, and that he would recover from that surgery. So we pray for Danny and Melody in this continued time of waiting. We also pray for Lydia's husband, Richie, as he recovers from surgery this week. Help him to heal quickly and to be free of pain. And we pray deeply and fervently this day, not just for members of our community and our congregation, but folks everywhere who live by themselves in this time of social distancing. 6 months is a long time, and we have much further to go. We pray for those who feel lonely. We pray for those who miss human contact and healthy physical contact. So be with those who are lonely, and help us to be family to them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we know that you walk with us and you answer when we call. So we lift up these prayers to you, and for what prayers we cannot even utter, we ask that your Spirit would intercess on our behalf with sighs too deep for words. So with gratitude and trust, we pray in the name of your beloved child, Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, with grateful hearts, let us give of our tithes and our offerings. Friends, let us pray. Oh God, use these gifts to do your will in the world and to prepare us for your coming kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, our final hymn this day is hymn number 515, I Come With Joy. Friends, we're so grateful that you could join us this day. As a friendly reminder, in case you missed it at the beginning of this service, we will have a special time together of both fellowship and worship in person this upcoming Wednesday evening at 6 p.m., not 6:30 like we've been doing, but at 6 p.m., we'll gather outside on our grassy lawn and we will stay socially distanced. And we invite you to bring your own chair, bring your own food. We'll have dinner together at 6. And then at 6:30, I'll lead a very casual time of worship together, of reading scripture and prayer. And I will bring my guitar and we'll strum along to a hymn or two. So if you, like me, have been missing that in-person element of worship, then we invite you to join us this Wednesday at 6. By my phone, we are ending about 9 minutes earlier than we usually do, and I'd like to make a suggestion for how you use that 9 minutes. Make a plan to vote. If you have not already done so, go ahead and figure out how you're going to vote. If you're voting via absentee ballot or mail ballot, go ahead and request it. If you have your mail-in ballot and you're ready to do so, go ahead and fill it out and don't wait. Put it in the mail. If you've already done these things, call up another member of the congregation or call up another friend and ask them if they have made a plan to vote. So friends, I would ask that you go out into the world and to seek to live into the kingdom that God is calling us to bring about. We have all been asked to work in the vineyard like the children in today's parable. Let us not only say that we will, but let's actually do it out in the world, because the vineyard is your backyard. So friends, as I say most weeks, do not be daunted by the enormity of the world's grief, but do justice now, love kindness now, walk humbly now. It is not your obligation to complete the work, but neither are we free to abandon it. So friends, in the name of God the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, may all of us, God's beloved children, say, Amen. Friends, go in peace.